11th is our patron saint day. Many of you are familiar with the history of this very early bishop of the church and a saint. And as I reflect on saints' lives, and this one in particular, I always have to ask myself, what difference did he make? And what can I learn from his example in my life? You know, we know from history, and you've heard this many times, that Martin was reared a pagan in what is today, modern day, or in the area of Hungary. He served as an officer in the Roman army for, I think, 20 years, as we are told. Legend has it that in 337, he was a catechumen, one preparing for baptism, one going through the process of learning about what it means to be a Christian. And he was, the famous story, he was passing through the city of Amiens on a winter morning. He spotted a beggar leaning against the city wall, and he, Martin, did not have any money to help him out, but was moved to help him. So he took his sword and cut the cloak that he was wearing, the warm cloak, and cut it in half and gave it to the beggar, keeping half for himself. And legend tells us that in a dream that very night, he had a vision of heaven. And in that vision, there was a celestial host of angels and archangels. And standing among them was Jesus, who said, "Martin, a simple catechumen, covered me with this garment." Shortly after this dramatic experience, this had to have been a soul-searching experience, Martin declared himself a Christian. He was baptized and shortly was ordained as a priest, somewhere between 350 and 353. Very early in the history of the Christian church. He became a monk under Hilary, who was bishop of Poitiers in France, where he had been stationed. He established the first monastery community in France. Later, after he had been there at the monastery, later to his dismay and over his protests, he was elected Bishop of Tours in 371. There is an interesting legend that you may have heard about concerning Martin's election as the Bishop of Tours. The story goes like this, and again, this may be legend, but it still sounds good. Martin heard of his election in 374 and was so horrified that he ran in and hid himself in a barn, thinking that nobody would find him and he could escape this bishop's stuff. A stupid, meddlesome goose found him there and made such a racket and a noise, the searchers were led to his hiding place. So one of the proper observances for this saint is roast goose. And that is actually a big thing in France. He later became the patron saint, or one of the patron saints of France, and was very popular among old Celtic Christians in Britain. In fact, Augustine, when the first Archbishop of Canterbury, when he first came to England, discovered that there was already a church in this, quote, pagan country. in Canterbury, and it was called St. Martin's. He came in 597, and there was already a Christian church, much to his surprise. He founded a Christian church, St. Martin's, at Canterbury, long before people really thought there were Christians there. Well, let's get back to Martin as Bishop of Tours. He was elected bishop while part of a monastic community, and he preferred simplicity in his life, as you would think a monk would do, and did not live the indulgent life that most bishops did in those days. He even retired to a place in the desert close by the sea city. From there, he carried out his duties as bishop. Martin's sacrifice was his service as a bishop of the church. I think one measure of his success is suggested by the fact that Martin was very unpopular among many of his fellow bishops simply because of his defense and his care for the poor, the helpless, the marginalized. He was also very opposed at that time to the bishops who felt like that there was a need to deal very harshly with heretics, with physical punishment and even execution. And Martin was opposed to that. Again, that caused him problems with his fellow bishops. A quote from the book, The Brightest and the Best. In his ascetic and exemplary simplicity, in his opposition to the heretic hunters, and his even-handed compassion, Martin's episcopate challenged the church and all the institutions influenced by the church. In that sacrifice, he probably clothed hundreds of beggars of all sorts and conditions and in hundreds of different ways. For Martin's gift, deployed in his episcopate, had the power to alter systems. Martin points us to the ministry of service that demands not the repression of our gifts, but the expression of them. Not a repudiation of our institutions, but a reformation of them. The legend says, interestingly, that Martin gave the beggar only half his cloak, keeping something for himself. Throughout his life, he held something for himself. He held fast to convictions that he would never surrender to the will of others, not even to ensure his own popularity. The portion he reserved constituted his gift and his sacrifice for God. So as we think about this man born in about 330 AD, in the early days of our faith, in the struggling days, in the formative days of our faith, in his surroundings, we have to believe not only was he a most remarkable and a courageous person, but one totally committed to the service of Christ and his Lord. As our patron saint and our example, we must ask those hard questions. Maybe Jesus asking of us, can we simplify our life today as Martin's goal was, leaving more time for our Lord and time to pray and time to listen to God? Do we make room in our busy church schedule to emphasize quiet time in conversation with our Lord? How are we doing with our time with God? That's a hard question for each of us. It's a hard question for me to answer as a bishop, because each of us has so much to do. I have so many duties, but I need time to have a conversation with my Lord. And we cannot forget the focus of Martin's ministry. He was formed in the monastic tradition of prayer and praise, devotion to our Lord. Through this, he and his fellow monastic community were led to the Spirit, to a life of service, to a life of service. All of that prayer and all of that sacrifice led them to serve God's children. Remember, he got into hot water with his fellow bishops because he reached out to the poor and the marginalized of his day. And he and his followers were always ministering to and reaching out to the pagan community around them and trying to do something with them and to share the gospel story with that pagan community. So, a hard question again for all of us. How are we doing with our ministry to those who are not in the church, and to those who don't have a church, and to those who have not heard the gospel of Jesus that we know and love? I remember a wise person saying some 2,000 years ago that the harvest is plentiful. That the harvest is plentiful out there. Yes, we have a challenge in our church here at St. Martin's. So did Martin in the middle and latter part of the 300s. He was unpopular with the establishment, but he followed the instructions of Jesus. I close with a quote from Forward Day by Day on August 3rd of this year. Through our commonplace experiences, we are witnesses to Christ living in all things. I pray that as the day unfolds, I may be Christ's apostle, speaking of those shining wings and joyous colors wherever my walk takes me.